great question, and I wish I had a simple answer. Various people have defined what critical materials are. Various countries have defined what critical materials are. Various academics have defined what critical materials are. There is, by and large, beginning to be some kind of consensus. But if we move over to what I call lists, so you might say, give me a list of what critical materials are, the lists around the world vary quite a lot. There are, however, when we move into the area of what we might term as more critical or more extremely critical materials, some commonalities. So we've heard already from other speakers in this MOOC about the rare earth elements, for instance, sometimes also known as the lanthanide series. We hear about platinum group metals, a range of six elements. So we often talk about elements. My research is more interested in the metal elements, and we've heard about metals and the challenges and the opportunities in a circular economy with metals. But they're sometimes very unusually named metals that society and sometimes companies are not so familiar with that they use them. How do we define them? What are the axes we use? Well, typically a lot of governments have said, if a material has insecurity of supply, a risk of insecurity of supply, and if it is of high economic importance to a country, then they put it into, and if it's high on both axes, then they say it's a critical material. But I quite like the work of people like Tom Gradel in Yale, and others, of course, who have put a third axis on this and say about environmental impact of these materials. So when you look at those types of axes, it gets more interesting as well on what is critical and what isn't. But in truth, it's a wide range of materials and other materials as well, not just metals, but other materials as well. So as just to recap, what is a critical material? Supply risk is high, economic importance is high, and environmental impact is high. When you start ticking those three boxes, you're starting to look at critical materials. But of course, there's a spread of those, so that can be lower in some axes and higher in others, and it still falls in as critical. But it depends on how you define those axes. If we take the European Union, for example, in 2010, they published a large report on defining what critical materials was. And they had 14 materials that they defined as critical. In 2014, they updated this, and it had risen to 20. So generally, the trend seems to be upwards, but it's a very complicated and dynamic field. But generally, there are more. In the late 20th, early 21st century, the growth in the use of some of these materials has really expanded. And they're in a range of technologies, many of which are solutions going forward, and I'll explain what I mean by that. You can look at a range of technologies like information communication technology applications, so we're thinking about mobile or cell phones, or we're talking about computers, the whole internet. These types of things use a lot of critical materials. If we're talking about other areas, such as renewable low-carbon energies, they often also use a lot of these materials, these critical materials. What is really important is we're very interested in a transition to a low-carbon economy. And obviously, energy generation is an important part of that, low-carbon energy generation. But there's also other parts to play with things like electric mobility, smart grids and smart cities. So when we look at those areas as well, we suddenly also come into a demand for critical materials. So again, we see there that the demand will and should rise as we want to reduce CO2 emissions. But that then also presents us with new challenges on how are we going to get a world of 7 to 11 billion people with a rising middle class answering these grand challenges, needing more critical materials to solve it without having the abundance of these materials that we would want in the world.